go right back.
Oh, yeah.
Gotta get right here.
You have it, yeah.
All right. Thank you, everybody, for coming. Thank you, Jen, for hosting us at Weatherby. Stop paying attention. Thank you, Jen. And we'll do a roll call. We received copies of the minutes from our last regular schedule. It was March 7th. That was at McGraw. Thank you, Ms. Briggs, for co-signing. She's here with that. Any changes we need to make to the minutes? What?
Throughout it, it just mentions that you were chair before the meeting, that you were late.
I was late.
So
I didn't do the adjustments to the agenda.
We just have one to be on the back.
We need a motion.
Well, I'm going to, rather than do a motion and then an amendment to motion, I'm going to ask for changes to the minutes first.
It also says policy committee says policy changes will be distributed more packets than if there was supposed to be regulations.
That for you? Mm-hmm. Those two changes. Is there any other change that needs to be made to the minutes before I ask for a motion? And the acoustics in this gymnasium are wonderful, but we need to speak up because our voices don't carry as well. So, John, I think the audience probably didn't hear you, so just speak up. Okay, thank you. Motion.
So moved. Second.
And all those in favor. Great, thank you. We do have one adjustment to the agenda.
Yes, we do. We have another coaching recommendation in addition to what was in your mailing. And that's going to be the Reed Brooks softball coach. I'll come later.
Great. Did we have a sign-up sheet for?
Yes, we did.
Whoever knows where that sign-up sheet exists?
Mr. Savage, right there by the door, there's a sign-up sheet right by the agenda. Did anyone sign up?
No.
Okay. Is there anyone in the audience who'd like to address the board this evening? Great. Under my report, this is the time of year where we elect the chair and the vice chair of the board. And I thank you, and I'm sure, well, I thank you both for allowing us there too for the past year to serve the board in this capacity. Wally, do you have something you'd like to share?
Yes, as vice chair, I just wanted to share with the board that there's some changes in my schedule at home. I will not be seeking re-election this November. And so with that, I would opt to not be chair or vice chair again next year.
Sad. He still has time to change his mind. But in other words, he won't accept the nomination if it's nominated. So we will move to elect the vice chair first. And so I'm looking for a nomination for the vice chair position.
I nominate then, sir.
Second.
Are there any other nominations?
Amanda Seidel.
I'll try to remember to repeat. Any other nominations for vice chair? Okay. Hearing none. All those in favor of Amanda Seidel, and do you accept that nomination? Do you willing? Okay, she's willing. So by a show of hands, if all are comfortable with that, all those in favor. Great, thank you. And for congratulations, Amanda. Fantastic.
That was the wedding in front of the full audience. You came back up.
And for the chair position, I'm looking for a nomination for a chair position. Scott.
And I'm going to Karen House.
Second.
Thank you. I'll accept that. Is there anyone else who would like to make a nomination for chair? Certainly wouldn't hurt my feelings. Okay. By a show of hands, all those in favor. Thank you very much. Amanda, I look forward to I'll be sure to miss your first meeting.
I'll pick you up.
All right, great. We'll go into personnel.
Under personnel, I have a number of resignations to report publicly this evening. First, at Hanlon Academy in the English department, Mike Maline is moving on to other opportunities. Also accepting the resignation of special education teacher down to Wagner, Lori Aragoni, who's been with us a number of years. Speaking about a number of years, after 41 years at Hamlin Academy, Dick Valentine is retiring fully at the end of this year. Wish him well. Kent Burnham, elementary teacher at the Smith Elementary School. And also in the central office, Lisa Swift, our payroll human resource manager, is leaving to accept a position at a higher level with the VZ school community. Just for the benefit of the audience, the VZ school community has had their payroll and accounts payable done with RSU 22 over the last 5 years. They're moving that back to VZ, and they're going to assign that to Lisa, and that's one of the reasons why she's connecting with that. But that's a big loss for us, and we've started advertising that position as of this past weekend. Now, nominations. If you reference your agenda notes in the adjustment tonight, we have four nominations. Alex Townsend, Hamlin Academy Boys Varsity Tennis Coach. Logan Houston, Hamlin Academy JV Co-Ed Tennis Coach. And JV Softball Coach, Demean Perry. And also at Reesboro Middle School, B Softball Coach is Danielle Valenti. So I recommend your approval of those four nominations, please.
Make a motion we approve them as a slate.
Second.
The motion is to approve as a slate. Any discussion? All those in favor? Great.
Thank you. No transfers to report this evening. So now we go into the superintendent schools report. Reading essential behaviors and outcomes proclamation this evening is Alan.
Education enables all students to learn the skills, acquire the knowledge, and develop the attitudes necessary for them to reach their potential as citizens who can meet the challenges of a changing global society. We believe that all citizens in our community share the responsibility to educate our children and themselves. Our schools are community support systems and should welcome and encourage all members of our communities to participate in our schools' level of supportive and empowering atmosphere for all students and communities.
Thank you, Alan. Under student recognitions, first, I'd like to introduce Mr. Tracy. He has some student athletes that he'd like to introduce to the board tonight. So, Mr. Tracy.
Come on up, guys. So, we're fortunate to have two amazing gentlemen with us. We have another one that is unable to attend as he's actually competing nationally in Pennsylvania right now. So, Cam LaBrie, during the winter sports season, swam for us at HA. He became the state champion in the 100-meter butterfly, and he also set a school record at 53.22 seconds in that same race. He couldn't be here tonight because he is, like I said, competing in the Y Nationals in Pennsylvania. So I'm sure he'd love to answer questions about how he's doing, but that's where he's at. From our far right, Ian McIntyre is a familiar face you've seen in basketball for the last 4 years at HA, a member of the Northern Maine Class A championship team, as well as a Mr. Basketball finalist, and of course, he surpassed 1,000 points this season, and what a phenomenal career he's had at HA. I told him they'd have to answer questions or give a speech or something. So if you have questions,
I'll put Ian on the spot because he and I talked back a couple weeks ago in the cafeteria. So why don't you share with the board where you're going next year?
We're going to Huston University where I'll be playing basketball and I'll be studying psychology.
Nice.
Everyone's another familiar face. Marcus Dunn from our last board meeting who presented the recruiting video that he created for us, a man of many talents. A bunch of things in hockey over his four-year career at HA that I want to mention. Portland Press Herald All-Star Selection, KVAC Class B Player of the Year, Hobie Baker Award semifinalist, surpassed 100 points for his career, and he was 59 points this season, 38 goals, 21 assists. That's most of any Class B player in the state, so that's a phenomenal four-year career. And I'll just add one more piece because it's only my first year at HA, but these three gentlemen, and I know Cam's not here, but they are wonderful citizens in our school. They're great leaders in our school, and I would say that their leadership among their teams, as well as in our school, has been so beneficial. So hate to see them go, but they've had great careers. So thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Tracy, gentlemen. Next, we have Mr. Moore with some advisors and students. So, gentlemen.
Good
Good evening. Thank you for having us here tonight. Our Inland County Robotics team is now in its fifth year competing with Mexico Robotics Competition. For the first 2 years, we had 7 students involved, and we split into 2 teams. For the past 3 years, we've had right around 25 students. Each of those years split into 4 teams. And during the course of this season, we actually have 5 teams, and now we have 5 teams. As you can see from our shirts, our team number is 9343, and our 5 teams are also designated with a letter, A, B, C, D, and E. These guys competed in 4 qualifying events during the school year, at John Babs twice, at Hallvale High School, and at Foxcroft Academy. And during those qualification events, 4 of the teams qualified to then compete at the state championship meet, which was held on March 3rd at Biddeford High School. And the team here tonight, 9343C, was able to team up with a team from Foxcroft Academy and from MDI, and they were a 3-team alliance, and they went on to become the state of Maine Vex Robotics champions. So they were the tournament champions. Tournament qualified them to compete at the World Championships, and we'll be going there from April 25th to the 28th in Louisville, Kentucky. And this also marks the 4th year in a row that Hampton Academy Robotics will be represented at the World Championships, which is a great accomplishment for the students. So these guys are all going to introduce themselves and talk a little bit about their roles on the team.
I am Austin Wilson. I've been in robotics for 2 years now. I am in 10th grade, and I am the builder and programmer for this robot.
I'm Ethan Dibley, and I am my 3rd year in robotics this year. And I'm a builder for the robot.
My name's Matthew Southern, and this is my 2nd year being on the robotics team. I'm in 10th grade, and I'm a builder slash driver for this robot. One of our members is not here tonight. His name is Robert Brown. He's in 10th grade, his 2nd year in robotics, and he's a builder. And now we got a little demonstration.
So the game this year is called Game Zone. This place is in both gold, blue and red on there, and yellow on there. Stack on the mobile goal are 2 points. And having the highest stack on the mobile goal is your bonus 5. And there's also a stationary goal where probably about 1.5 there where you can stack cones on it as well. And you get 2 points for each cone on that, plus a bonus 5 for
the
highest stack. Dead batteries.
So what they would do now is they would drive over on the 12x12 course, there, the field, there is scoring zones in each corner. And there's a 5-point zone, a 10-point zone, and a 20-point zone. So now you would deliver the mobile base over to, as far into the high scoring zones as you can. Also out on the field, there's two stationary bases that are about this tall, and they can go around and pick up one cone at a time and stack on top of those cones. And this, the scoring situation is very confusing, to say the least, the way they do it. But obviously the team with the highest score, the alliance with the highest score, is what will win the match. Do you remember what your final score was?
It was 115.
115 points. And each of the yellow cones only count as two. So moving them into different areas, there's 94 of these yellow cones in that 12 by 12 area. And there's four robots going, trying to get it at all the times. So I'm just gonna leave it there for that. Yeah. So everyone gets to talk about the fun stuff. I get to talk about the numbers. So as you all know, we are headed off to, as Mr. Huff said, we're headed off to Kentucky. Unfortunately, it does cost a lot of money. We are very thankful to the board. We're thankful to Mr. Lyons for supporting our registration and our expenses for the coaches. Everything else, we fundraise as a team. And I'm just gonna go over those numbers with you real quick, just so you know. We're taking four students, two coaches. The registration alone was $975. Airfare from Bangor to, we're actually flying into the Cincinnati airport, but it's in Kentucky. But it's $200 cheaper per ticket to do that, and it's a 90-minute drive. So, and we always rent a vehicle as well. So the airfare is $3,042. Our hotel is $1,936. Vehicle rental is $467. After the competition is all over and everyone's getting ready to go, that Saturday night they close down a Six Flags park that's now called Kentucky Kingdom. These guys and Mr. Huff will have access to all the rides, not this guy. it's a full buffet. That's $180 for the whole team to take part in that. The students are responsible for a little bit of money, however they decide to raise it. They can fundraise it, their parents can pay it, however the family decides. That's $150 each. One of the things that we are required to do at the competition is to give things away for free. So we take, since our logo is the gearhead, we 3D print these little gears with our team number on it. We'll give those away, and then I'm not a big fan of little rubber bracelets, but they go like wildfire out there. So we have about 400 of each of these that we'll give away, and that helps your team get notarized or get, you know, people, makes you more, what am I looking for? People will think of you more if you're giving away stuff. We get judged on our booth. We will have teams coming from all over the world to work with our kids at that event. So our total cost of our trip is right now at $6,692.18. Total raised or contributed so far is $5,864.36. So we still need to raise another $827.82. And the only thing that we have not included on here is we always try to buy our the winning, if we have a successful team, we'll always sell sponsorships for our team, so we have our kids and Mr. Huff and I will go to all these businesses and ask for donations. They sponsor us, and then we try to buy some sweatshirts and whatnot, so we go out there and we look as a full team. We have not priced that out yet. We're close to that. We have to wait till this Friday before we know what that price will be because of the sponsorships on the back. So that's where we're headed. Like I said, we're almost there at $825 still to go.
$300.
Thank you to Mr. Frank. He and his company are gonna make a donation tonight. So we're down to $327. So that's a huge help. So again, thank you for that. So That's what we're up to.
Mr. Moore, yes. Approximately, how many, when you say worldwide, how many students are there? How large is it?
Students?
Yeah.
There's over 1,000 teams there.
A thousand teams
could have five or 10 kids, students on.
Okay.
I would say on an average, there's going to be 15,000 people. There's an auditorium. We are at, in Louisville, we are at the largest indoor fair facility in the United States.
1.2 million square feet.
And there's two auditoriums, one just about the size of the Cross Center, one just a little bit smaller. We will totally fill that Cross Center, the size of the one there, the size of the Cross Center with kids.
At our next meeting in May, they postponed our DI teams, are also won the national competition. And I had the occasion years ago to go one of those. It's absolutely phenomenal, if you can well imagine all these national competitions. When you see 1,000 teams.
I think Pumas, the most exciting thing to see is to see these kids come over and these kids from all over the world. They don't speak English. Mm-hmm. And they're going to come up to these guys and they're going to start talking. And it doesn't even matter what language they're talking, they're understanding each other because they're talking about the same thing. And then every once in a while, especially for Mr. Huff and I, we have to flag down the people wearing the fluorescent orange cap, and they're the ones that are the translators, and they'll translate for us. But to watch our kids do that, it's just amazing.
So did you say you have 8,500 unsupervised robot builders at a mechanized theme park?
Yep. Yep. It's fun. It's good.
Just fun. Safe.
Yep. I would have been sometimes. Yes.
In past years, you guys have done a GoFundMe page. Is that up and running now?
We are not doing a GoFundMe this year because it is so hard for the school system to accept funds through GoFundMe.
Okay.
It has to be set up through someone's personal account, and then you have accounting issues going from a personal account into the school account. So we did not set one up this year.
Okay.
Yep.
Does this guy have a name, or did I miss that?
It's had several names to
it. It's repeatable names.
I don't think it really does this year.
Last minute.
That's appropriate. Last minute is very appropriate. Anything else? Great.
Okay, gentlemen, thank you very much. Good luck.
Data that's solid versus the warm and fuzzies that I sometimes work off of a lot, that I feel the need or someone has said to me. Wally and I and our wellness committee take a look at this information, and we and Mr. Lyons and I have looked at it quite in depth to see where we need to focus some of our energy. You'll see this information when she presents it, but just have a great feeling about our kids. The way we compare in the state, we're doing a really good job, but we can always continue to be better and to offer more things to our kiddos. So I wanted to share with you these. This was sent out in the board packet 2 board meetings ago. I'm not sure if it got on for this one, so I printed a couple. There may not be enough because everyone's here, which is excellent, but it's a snapshot. This presentation is also available if you would like to have it. And at any time, if you want to sit down and talk with me about any of this information, please. I work as a health and wellness coordinator on Tuesdays, Thursdays, and Fridays, and I love to talk. So that is for you guys to pass it down, and we'll get this set up.
And consulting firm in Portland, Maine. I've been with the firm 2 years now, and one of my primary projects is working with substance use prevention with youth and adolescents. And one of our main drivers for data is the Maine Integrated Youth Health Survey. This survey has been going on for quite a few years now. The first rendition was in 2009, and it's a collaboration between the Maine Office of Substance Abuse and Mental Health, Maine Center of Disease Control and Prevention, and the Maine Department of Education. It collects a number of indicators based on student substance use, risk factors related to substance use, consequences, students' perceptions, and risk factors to other substances. There's many versions of the survey. It's given to 7th and 8th graders, as well as 9th through 12. The data is cleaned by an organization, and then they send it to us to analyze. So when we're looking at this data, it's important just to realize that we do have a really strong sample size here, but it's still a sample, so that means that there's chances that there's slight differences between populations. Typically, we don't really look too much if it's like plus or minus 5%. So we'll make that our general rule while we're looking through the data. And sometimes you get a cohort of students that might just be generally different than the cohort before them, so just keep that in mind. Some of the terms that we'll use is past 30-day use, so that means that within the past 30 days, whether they've used a substance, that's really the indicator that we use for consumption versus lifetime use, because that's saying that they're using more often. So today's goals, we're going to examine substance use trends over time, show use patterns by characteristics, consider the attitudes, risks, and assets of the students, and then discuss implications and next steps. So looking at 2017 past month use, it's not going to mean a lot because you're not really looking at the trends yet, but this is just looking at middle school and high school students. You'll see quite a few asterisks throughout the presentation. That just means the data was suppressed, meaning there wasn't a big enough sample size to report the data. So as you can see here, alcohol remains one of the biggest substances that's consumed. It's like that across most of Maine. And secondly, marijuana, which has gotten to be a hot, hot-button topic, and high school use is greater than middle school use. So for high school students, the trends are going in a very positive direction. You can see since 2011, there's been some substantial decreases in all substances, which is really great to see. And a lot of that is to the work that local coalitions are doing to really increase students' perceptions around substance use. And it just lends hand to giving lots of dollars to this. I don't have the same slide for middle school students just because there's not as much data in the sample size for middle school. So this is for lifetime use, so have they ever tried a substance? So as you can see, alcohol still remains one of the highest, followed by marijuana. But something to really pay attention to here, most of the time there's a large difference between high school and middle school, and here are prescription drugs and inhalants. There's really not quite a difference. So that's something to be mindful of when looking at programming. So these are lifetime trends for middle school. They're going up a little bit, but that's not to say that it's a huge problem, just that it's something to make note of. As I said before, looking at plus or minus 5% is really the telltale that you have a serious problem, and this also lends maybe a cohort of students that maybe were using more than others. So similar, these are the trends of high school, and so as we've seen in the past 30 days, we can also see that lifetime use is also decreasing since 2011. So lifetime prescription drug misuse is an indicator that can no longer be trended, just because in 2015 versus 2017, the question is asked differently. So every year there's a council that comes together and they change some of the questions to make them more specific just to get better data. And so unfortunately we won't be able to trend it. So this just so shows the lifetime prescription drug misuse in high school students from 2011 to 2015, which decreased slightly in high school and then went up a little bit in middle school, and as you can see, they're almost identical for the new question. And so instead of asking if they've taken any prescription drugs, which they lumped in some of the opioids along with like Ritalin and Adderall, so now they're just asking if they've taken any prescription pain medicine. I'm sure you are well aware of the epidemic that we have going on across the state that affects all ages, and so they just want to get a little bit more specific around that data. Also, they've changed the way that they're counting binge drinking. So binge drinking has been a big problem in schools as well, not just looking at alcohol, but looking at the number of drinks students are consuming. So it used to be they asked, you know, in the past 30 days, how many days did you have five or more drinks in a row? And now they're just asking, what is the largest number of drinks that you had? So we can see a little bit better at, you know, what number of drinks these students are having, and maybe look at our programming to send information out to kids at various levels. So this is middle school compared to Maine. So you can see in almost all facets that Maine, that you're doing a little bit better than the Maine average, except looking at the prescription drugs and inhalants, which we've seen in the data already. And this is for high school, so as you've seen in the data with the past 30-day and lifetime use, high school students are doing relatively well here at RSU 22 and doing much better than the state averages throughout Maine. So this is just looking at substance use by grade, and one can most likely assume the older you get, the more likely you are to try some of these substances, which is also depicted by this data, except when you get into the prescription drugs and inhalants, and that's just due to the what we've already seen before with the middle school students. So this is interesting because we've had a little bit of a flip-flop in the last few years. I don't have it trended here, but you know, most of the time everybody's like, oh, we need to really concentrate our programming on the males. It's the males that are doing the substance use a lot more than the females. But now, even throughout the state, we're seeing that there's been an uptick in females using substances and reporting that they're using substances. And there's a possibility that this might be due to mental health issues that females are also going through. So you'll see on the next slide, we do what we call a crosstab. So we look at the number of students who answer that they've used a substance in the past 30 days, and also in their lifetime, with whether they reported that they were sad or hopeless for 2 weeks. So that's what we sort of consider depression. So there was 22.6% of high school students indicated that they were sad or hopeless for 2 weeks. And as you can see in this data, that those are significantly more likely to use substances, especially at least once in their lifetime, and with alcohol and marijuana. And we don't have a lot of slides here, but adverse childhood experiences, ACEs, is a new buzzword that we're really looking into as being a critical factor that leads to substance use. Another contributing factor that we see is students who identify as lesbian, gay, or bisexual. So 12.2% of students indicated that they identified as lesbian, gay, or bisexual. And you can also see that they also indicated a higher rate of use for all substances. So it's not all bad. There's both contributing factors and attitudes and perceptions that may lead to substance use. So these are how easy students believe that it is to attain these different substances. And as you can see, high school typically is more easy to obtain than what middle school students believe, except for prescription drugs. And that's something that we definitely want to look at programming around, safe storage, and just getting a lot more information around attitudes and beliefs to students so they don't feel that it's easy for them to obtain prescriptions. And then whether it poses little risk or harm to them, pretty even, except for marijuana. We've actually been flagged because if you're over 50% of students believe that there's a slight risk, you have to relook at all your data. So the entire state last year, we had to look at our data because it actually went above the 50% just because of the climate that we have going on. Yeah, which it's an interesting point because although high school students believe that it doesn't pose little risk or harm to them, we haven't really seen an uprise in them reporting that they're using marijuana. So it just aids that we should really look at getting the information out there about how marijuana affects the brain so that number can go down. So there's other contributing factors that are more protective factors that help kids and youth not use substances. So that's been really a shift in prevention recently. We really want to focus on these positive factors that enhance youth experience. So family having clear rules about alcohol, tobacco, and other drugs that's ACOM. Talking to parents about school weekly. And then some of the negative ones are not caught by parents for drinking alcohol. Parents accepting of alcohol use. That's only 4% of high school students indicated that. Or as you can see with what's going on with marijuana, unfortunately, it's probably going to keep rising, parents accepting of marijuana use. So we need to get the messaging not just to the youth and students, but also send it home to their parents as well. So looking at the school climate, so very high numbers for students feeling safe at school. Also for having at least one teacher or caregiver who gives them support. Middle school students feel as though the school enforces rules more fairly than high school students. And we're also gonna focus a little bit more on bullying. So students, 50%, one in two middle school students have been bullied. and something that we're really focusing a lot more on, and it was a new question this year, was whether they were electronically bullied or not. So social media has really contributed to a lot of this. And then pretty low numbers still for offered or sold drugs at school. So just looking how students answered in 2017 for past month mental health and suicide. So there were 28.10% and 22.6% of students who indicated that they had felt sad or hopeless. So that's what they consider depression as far as the MIAS is concerned. And about, you know, a little over 1 in 10 students have actually made a plan about how they would attempt suicide. And half of those students actually attempted suicide. And then a little lesser degree, do something to hurt yourself without wanting to die, is actually a lot more than making a plan. And suicide ideation is a similar factor that they're looking at. So we wanted to see how RSU-22 matched up against Penobscot County and Maine, so we could get a tell on how your school is doing. So it's pretty similar across the board, if not a little bit better. The one thing I do want to point out, though, is doing something to purposely hurt yourself without wanting to die is higher here at RSU-22 than it is for the state average in Penobscot County.
I have a quick question.
Sure.
The actual attempted suicide, is that percentage of the students that made a plan, or is that?
It's all total students, yeah. So this is doing another, what we call crosstab, so looking at students who have been bullied and comparing that to some other indicators. So of the students who have been bullied, 20.7% also considered suicide ideation, and 7.4% for middle school. You can see that depression, half of students that have been bullied also experienced depression. And you can see the numbers also are significantly higher across all the factors. So bullying is, you can say, related to depression and suicide. And so we did that again also just looking at electronic bullying. And so with middle school students, is the far to the left, so the sad, hopeless, making a plan, and the suicide ideation, and then high school starts over again at the sad and hopeless, which 60.4% is pretty high of those students who have been electronically bullied also have depression, and 1 in 2 students who were electronically bullied have done something to purposely hurt themselves without wanting to die. So it's just something to look at and keep in mind when we're talking to youth, and doing programming as well. So they call these the PAN indicators, so physical activity and nutrition. It's pretty average across the state. It's kind of low for high school students, getting vegetables 3 times a day, fruit juice, sweetened drinks, and physical activity should be around 50%, so you're almost there. So there's areas to celebrate. So there's been a dramatic decrease in the past 30-day substance use among high school students. So cigarettes is down 59.1% from 2009. Alcohol is down 39.9%. Prescription drug misuse 24.4%. And marijuana 42.6%. So 9 out of 10 middle school students and high school students identified that their parents have clear rules about alcohol, tobacco, and other drugs. 9 out of 10 middle school students and 8 out of 10 high school students have indicated that they talk to their parents weekly about school. So those are the protective factors that we want to continue to support in the students. And just some areas of concern. So middle school lifetime use of alcohol, prescription drugs, and inhalants has increased from 2015 to 2017. Lifetime prescription drug misuse is 4.8% higher in RSU compared to the state average. 6 in 10 high school students believe there's little to no risk to smoke marijuana once or twice a week. Special populations such as those with mental health needs and identifying as LGB have a greater risk of substance use. And students who have been bullied are at greater risk for mental health issues and suicide ideation. So some questions to consider. How do these findings support or conflict with what you've seen and observed in the school system? Are there certain groups or populations of concern that may not be mentioned? And how can the community and RSU 22 help address these concerns? Thank you. Does anybody have any questions? I know it's a lot of data. There's a overview sheet in your packets. I'm more than happy to share that with you as well, just sort of listing out all the major data points. We're really focused on using data to really drive decision making, so that's why we really support this work.
Were transgender students included in the LGB, or is that just kind of left off, or wasn't identified as a group?
Yeah, they were. So it was gay, lesbian, transgender. If they answered other, then they weren't included in either group, straight or LGB.
When will we administer this next time?
2019. Jill, write that down.
I got it on the brain.
Question on the marijuana health impact. Do you see a sharp uptick on that when the majority of adults in our state deem that recreational marijuana should be legal?
Yeah, it's been growing slightly from 2013 was the first time we really saw an increase, and then when the 2015 survey hit, that's right around that time of the laws, it increased over 50%, which it's comparable to, you know, Colorado and the western states, but it was a big deal here in Maine. But the good thing, you know, about your students is, and compared to other districts, is we haven't seen an uptick in the past 30 day use of marijuana, so that's good.
I do want to remind the board members, we've been collecting this data for approximately 15 years now. We're very fortunate, we're probably one of make it up 22 or 23 districts in the state that have a school health coordinator versus 10 years ago there were like 85 in the state when funding went away and the school health coordinators went away. So this is a big virtue in my opinion for us that we really integrate data. And Megan is saying how do you tie the programming as well. Megan, thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Sometimes I put myself on a branch when I kind of give numbers, but 10 years ago we had around 85 school health coordinators statewide, and now we're down to less than 5.
And that's because the state cut the funding. It was funded through the tobacco settlement funds, through
healthy
main partnerships and
companies. That's significant. So Brittany is a facilitator for our next group who's going to coordinate their talk. And this is a follow-up from our child abuse policy we discussed back a few meetings ago. And the board wants to have some information on how does this play into potential referrals to DHHS. So, Brittany?
So this was a topic we discussed in our district-wide safety committee, so we brought it up during admin council. I'm like, I got this. I will work on getting everyone up here to be able to talk to this subject. So I have Kelly O'Brien and Jill will come up and we'll do a little presentation on what we're doing within the district. I also have nursing here if there's any questions that are relevant.
Do
you want to step on
the
microphone? So thank you for having us. I'm Jill Kenny, one of the co-directors of Guidance in the district.
I'm Kelly O'Brien. So we're just here to talk briefly about our process in the district for nurses and guidance counselors on how we report child abuse and neglect. So we're going to do this in two parts. I do want to start by saying that while most of us do things the same way, there are some differences. For example, nurses in the district use data to actively analyze and look at patterns of injuries, bruising, red marks on students. They take photographs of these injuries and compare them day to day, particularly at the elementary levels. I don't know if there's anything you want to add. I was afraid that I was going to butcher what Mrs. Heron told me today. So usually I can speak for myself when I'm in a situation where I need to report child abuse or neglect. I'm usually calling in Barb, who's right next door. I feel very lucky. And then we're kind of tag team, and she does what she needs to do as a nurse, and I do what I need to do as a counselor. So you all have, I believe, a handout. It's a flow chart made by Kelly, which is really pretty. There are two sides. The side on the right is the side that I'm going to talk about. And basically, this is the process for someone who initially hears a report of child abuse. So whether it be a teacher, a nurse, a counselor with a student sitting in front of you, we follow this process on the right. So we hear about the report, we ask all of the questions we need to ask to get information. We're taking notes, taking pictures if we need to. And we're filling out a form called the Suspected Child Abuse and Neglect Form. And if the offender or the person who is hurting the child or neglecting the child is a guardian of the child, we would report this to the Department of Health and Human Services that day. And we would also fill out Section 2, so we fill out this whole form. And then the document is filed in a central location in the school counselor's office, the nurse's office, and a copy with the administrator. There is a slight difference if the offender is not a direct guardian of the child. We would report to DHHS and also to the district attorney, which kind of elevates the level of severity and seriousness and gets more people on the case to investigate the situation. And the same form is also filled out and filed in the same areas. And then that, I believe, is my part. Thank you. So in a perfect world, we would only need the right side of that form. It's best for the person who first heard allegations to make the report to DHHS. However, we can't just mandate reporting. We also need to create a supportive environment for our staff and colleagues to feel safe making those reports, and that's why you see the left side as well. So in the situation where a staff member feels more comfortable making the report with a school counselor, administrator, etc., the same steps at the beginning apply that Jill explained. However, you'll see the dark purple box at the bottom. That is a spot where we create some checks and balances. So for example, if a teacher at Weatherby heard of alleged abuse or neglect and they didn't feel comfortable making the report on their own, they might come to me and then we could make the report together. I then owe that staff member a signature saying, "This is good. We did our due diligence and it's been reported." After I sign it, the staff member would sign it, and then it's filed in that spot. The reason that that seems like there are a lot more steps is just to make sure that we're doing right by the child. School counselors also use a lot of data to proactively make reports as well. We don't just reactively make reports when we hear that something has happened. So we do surveys in whole group guidance class, including school climate surveys, belonging to school surveys, personal safety surveys. We are on attendance teams to make sure that students are attending school. We look at behavior data.
And school counselors are leaders at our buildings on student assistance teams, student response teams, and HEART teams. Do you have any questions?
Oh, you might want to elaborate on HEART team, just so the board has it.
So HEART is an acronym for the High School Student Response Team. Our student assistance team stands for Hampton Academy Response Team. And we discuss students weekly based on certain risk factors that come to our attention, such as attendance issues, failing classes, getting detentions, getting suspensions, and support visits. We track how many times they need support from the guidance counselors or the nurses.
Thank you.
Can I piggyback on that? And that's, this isn't steering us too far to the left, but related to the presentation we just had and then what you just said in regards to discipline, and that's part of your conversation regarding suspensions and so forth. On the suspension report for Hampton Academy, we've seen a trend that substance use is continuing to be, and yet I'm not seeing any referrals to substance abuse treatment or social work. And I'm just trying to figure out why, because early intervention, the data supports that. And so is that part of your conversation?
Absolutely.
And can you give me some context?
Yes, so many times students have outside providers where they already have a counselor or a clinician, and in that case we will either have already obtained a release to speak with that person, or we will get one as part of the process, so that wouldn't necessarily go in a detention or a suspension letter. And I know that whether it's listed in the letter or not, Mr. Raymond, Mr. Tracy, guidance, nurse work very closely together to make the referrals for students who don't have outside services. So we are fortunate enough at the high school to contract with Acadia to have a clinician on our staff. She has many roles, and one of those roles is to meet with students at least three times when they have violated the substance abuse policy, and then make a recommendation. Do they need ongoing treatment? Was it a one-time incident? And she's also in contact with their parents.
So specifically, as I look at this current month report, we had 8 students suspended because of substance abuse. Meg, a question to you. This, can you elaborate on the vape pen? Because that seems to be something that's been really accelerated the last three months. Can you speak to that, please?
Yeah, so unfortunately, the way that the VAS is designed, the questions go, you know, it's only every 2 years, so they're a little bit behind with the vape pen, but it is something that Maine CDC and Prevention is definitely pushing out a lot more materials around. There was a question around e-cigarettes, but they didn't get into what exactly was going into the vape pen, because it opens up a whole door to all kinds of different substances that can be used for it. But we have seen, and they're looking at utilizing a lot of that tobacco money to push back towards the vaping.
Thank you.
So I'm just wondering, with the 8 students, those all did get those 3 sessions. It's just not reflected on this.
It's an ongoing, so they will be getting, yes. Okay. We have to have parent signatures before they can see our clinician.
I guess what I'm just trying to get my head around, Bill, is if there's a way we can even modify this report to show a bigger picture of the board of what's actually being done rather than just suspending the student. You know what I mean? Because I'd actually like to know that we're actually trying to help the student.
That's a good point. Matter of fact, the board members have been here a couple of years ago. We actually did this last year. We modified it to bring in-school suspension and other things as well. So that's a good idea. Okay, we can look to see how we can strengthen that.
So what do we mean as a HEART team? We always discuss things like this and things are coming up. And knowing that this was coming up, actually, we had the discussion last week around modifying that. And we were going to have a conversation with Mr. Raymond about just how we report that and how it looks. So I think that will add some consistency and some follow-through.
In just reporting. We know it's happening, it's just a matter of...
Right, and so my question is, if it's not happening, is it because of a budget issue? Because then we want to make sure we look at those contracts we have with Acadia and see if we need to increase that.
The other thing I would add to it is just the fact that, so we do contract with Acadia, but we also have another Acadia worker that comes in and has offered some case management pieces now, which allows us to attack things at a totally different level than we
had been at the beginning of the year. So that's been a huge benefit for us, and not just working with the student themselves, which our staff does a phenomenal job anyway, you know, but having that case management service to work with the family, to work with the parent, the mother, the father. And that's been a huge, I feel like a huge benefit for us.
Bill, how many hours a week do we receive from Acadia?
That's a better question for Barb and Jill.
Why am I thinking 25 in my post?
We have a full-time clinician, yep. And we also have the part-time clinician. She's there one day a week.
Thank you.
So Jenny was there. She's our yes. Part-time, and she was there early on, only a little bit, seeing a few students, and she said, the more that come to us, the more that we can support, the more I can be here. Right. So it's been a very fruitful partnership.
Rick, I'd also like to just let the board know that we, Officer Stewart and I, are going to do a presentation to all the faculty at the high school about vaping and juuling, so that they can more quickly recognize that than the students as well. Because some of it's brand new to the faculty. The Juul, I'll show you one of the Juuls. It actually looks like a little hard drive.
Yeah. Meg, just as an observation, one thing that did not surprise me on your immense amount of data, to paraphrase the one where the parents have the acceptance of marijuana. By board policy, I meet with students who have been suspended because of substance abuse. And I can tell you, a large percentage of the time, I'm in awe when the parents say to me, to paraphrase their sentiment, I don't see anything wrong with this. Our standard is higher than the home standard. And when they walk away, I just wonder about that. That 14% that you had, I thought it was actually going to be higher. Mm-hmm.
That's students reporting that their parents.
Yes.
So there's also a parent survey, which I didn't present on. That data is not being released till the end of this month, but I'll definitely pass on some of that data along to see what that looks like in your area.
Any other questions, board members, for our presenters and our nurses? Anybody?
Jim?
Yes. Looking at the flowchart, when the offender is not a parent or guardian, of course you have to contact the authorities. Why is there nothing in here about contacting the parent?
We should probably add that. It's something that we just know to do, but we should probably add it to that.
So you do that?
Oh, absolutely.
I'm good.
Absolutely.
Okay, ladies, thank you very much. Appreciate it. Thank you. Now we move down to the update on freedom of access request. Hopefully my two exhibits were self-explanatory. To draw your attention to the obvious, in Exhibit A was the dropping of the purchase orders, which you can see by the hours was in excess of 100 hours. So that obviously equally reduced the fee. We have received the check from the individuals that were in the process of finding those documents and then distributing in approximately 6 to 7 weeks. Anyone have any questions or any further thoughts? Okay. Lucas, you have an academy?
I have nothing to present.
You have nothing? Okay, thank you. And Mrs. Nichols.
Start off with the Warren article summary. And there are enough for the audience if any of you are interested as they come down. From each of our warrant articles up until this point, actually 4 o'clock today. Our expenditures are moving through the budget just as we would expect. We feel as though we have about one third of our expenditures remaining as we come along to the last quarter of the school year. There are a couple of articles that we have spoken about before, such as Article 10, debt service that is expended to a greater degree. That makes sense because your principal payments are made in November. Your interest payments come along in May, so the remaining 15% would be expended out this month. Salaries and benefit lines are seeming to be right on track. Our CTE assessment, which is Article 3, we pay to UTC. And because because our school year doesn't align exactly with the fiscal year, we pay on a bit of a different cycle, so it's spent down, drawn down a bit more than we would in other lines. Are there any particular questions on any of the articles?
What is the actual percent of year remaining? Is it 30, are we at 30% roughly?
Just roughly.
Calendar days left or something?
Well, this would go into June 30th.
Okay, we're going to continue.
All right, so I'll move on to the Assistant Superintendent's report. I'd like to give you a budget meetings update. Of course, last night, several of you were in attendance at our first budget committee meeting, and at that meeting, we focused on giving the foundations for how funding has come to our SHRE 22 this year, and some of the effects that have been felt not only in our district but across the state with valuation differences. Valuations and property tax have gone up considerably, and our SHRE 22 has certainly felt the pinch of that. I'd also like to let you know that we did meet with the town managers on Monday, and that was an important meeting because we wanted to be sure that we're communicating with our town officials so that they had the lay of the land around how our funding was coming into our SHRE 22. We had some great discussion about perspectives on needs in each of the towns regarding taxation and different avenues that the district would be considering to make sure that we're attentive to what those needs are. So we did have attendance from every town in our RSU, so we're very appreciative of that. Okay, UTC funding shift. We just would like to give you notice that UTC will be receiving their funding directly starting next fiscal year, so we will no longer be seeing an Article 3 because that funding will flow directly to the center. One thing you do need to know, however, is that the transportation costs associated with sending our students to UTC will remain with the district as a responsibility. So our transportation costs will go up next year. That transportation cost has been included in our assessment that we have been paying all along, but since we won't be assessed any longer, transportation turns to us.
Just a quick question on that. So the transportation has been funded out of the assessment. The entire assessment is now being moved to UTC. So, and is that a state level decision, or how did that, as part of the budgeting?
It's a state level decision. We have a center for CTE that actually has one of the lowest costs per pupil in the entire state. They will be receiving a slight bump next year with funding coming in, but there's a hold harmless provision across the state, so centers that actually were receiving more than the funding formula would typically allot will not be penalized for that. And our center won't receive as much as the funding formula probably should allow for a center of our size. But the decision around the transportation is outside of that, and the state feels as though we are being reimbursed for the transportation because the UTC transportation counts are reported to the state, and that they're keeping those in that line on our funding formula at ED279.
So are they insinuating that we've always been getting kind of a double pay for that then? Because we've been paying it to UTC and getting paid to transport them also?
Well, it hasn't been said that way, but yes.
That's certainly the implication. Mm-hmm. It's just, when the new money came through in the last budget cycle, there's a lot of talk about how is this going to, if new money comes with new financial responsibilities, it's not really new money. Mm-hmm. It's just a shift of responsibility. That's and exactly. This is actually a shift of responsibility and less money in this particular case.
Correct. If I can interject my opinion, I had a hunch, and my hunch was correct. I had a call from the superintendent in another region today. I want to identify the region. But in that particular region, the vocational school is going to add a local assessment adjustment to make up the difference. So in other words, if UTC thinks that they're $500,000 short, this particular region is now billing the local district to pick up that $500,000 difference from the state. you're following what I'm saying. I don't want to be a little bit evasive, but I want to give you a heads up on my fear in the next 2 years that may happen. So just be informed that we may be looking for a local adjustment.
Another way to perhaps look at it is if the current payout is $392,000 to UTC buyers, it's possible that the state will reimburse them at a rate quite a bit less based on their evaluations. And there will be a gap.
We're going to have to watch this very carefully.
That's been a topic of discussion. Yes. If you fall short, you have to assess the local rules. Yep. Yep. The school has to
Yep. play it. Yep.
Okay. Tonight, in new business, we will be hearing a motion for a resolution to authorize the turf and lighting project and the financing regarding the project. Let me just give you a little backdrop as to what we're having recommended. The Finance Committee met and will be moving forward a recommendation to you that we actually go ahead and defer our bond through the Maine Municipal Bond Bank to be funded in November rather than May. And the reason for this is that RSU 22 has been in the process of seeking three major grants, one from Alphon Foundation, another from Hannaford, and then another from the CSD Council. Some of the amounts that we're asking for are quite substantial, $400,000, for instance. If any of that grant money was to come back to us, of course, we would like to be able to use that for the cause and reduce the request from the towns because our bond is an up to figure. If we go ahead and sign for the bond in May and we receive grant money on June 1st, we would not be able to prepay our bond. So we have been advised that going with a bond anticipation note from April through November, defer the bonding, would help us to have the money that we need, but give us the freedom to be able to accept outside money and hopefully reduce the bond after the end. So we would like to move forward with a resolution tonight to do two things. One is to say, yes, we're authorizing the project to move forward, and secondly, bond anticipation note and subsequent bonding to the municipal bond bank would be accepted. So that's what you will be voting on. Any comments on that from Finance Committee members?
Oh,
yeah, go ahead.
No, thanks, David. Oh, I can go first.
No, I just want to say that we did talk about it. I mean, I think it was pretty much unanimous that it was something that's good for everyone. I mean, to push that out, take a little bit of a risk, but even if we got even just a little bit of funding, we'll cover our expenses, so it's worth the risk, I think.
So what's the anticipated cost of the bond?
The interest rates right now are quite competitive and low. We're hoping for somewhere in the ballpark of 2-3% interest. I have not gone out to any bidding process for that because I need authorization first. So if I receive that tonight, I will go out tomorrow and I'll be hearing more specifics.
So the and when do we have the bond anticipation note by? So basically, over what amount of time are we going to have how much money from the bond anticipation? So I can I judge if we get a 2 or 4%, how much is that going to cost the district, I guess?
What we're going to be doing is talking with the vendors. We are going to have a report about the bidding process coming out quite soon. We'll be able to speak with the vendors and understand what their payment schedules are going to need to be. So seeing that the project is supposed to be completed August 15th, we may have to go for the full $850 in the bond anticipation note, depending on how those payment schedules come along. So, you know, quick money for 5 months at the most, 4%.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I have continued with budgeting presentations to RSU 22 faculty members. I certainly would like to thank the principals. They've been very gracious about giving staff meeting time so I can communicate directly with faculty members. I feel like it's been a positive interaction and a wonderful step, not only for us to be able to explain budgeting principles, but also to receive feedback and perspective from those who are actually executing the budget dollars every day. So it's been well worth the time and the interaction. Thank you to all the folks who have said yes to a half an hour or 45 minutes here and there. I will continue to each of the schools. We're doing round two now. We've collected feedback from the staff, and I'm going back to answer some of their questions and give them information regarding some of their concerns. We are having the finance job posted for payroll and HR. As you heard tonight, Lisa Swift has resigned, and so that is actively out there right now, and we have received a couple of inquiries, so we're hopeful to follow up on those.
Sorry, so that is a quasi-HR position as well?
Well, I'd say it's very loose on the HR component. That's something that hopefully Regan over the next year or two can frame up and bring some options to the board to move that forward. Yeah.
I'd say it more around her function than
gotcha.
A three degree.
Yeah. Yes. Is that listed as a part-time or full-time?
It's a full-time position. Okay, we did have the turf and lighting project bid openings yesterday. I gave you a handout that shows the results of those bid openings. Those bids are unevaluated, so that means that we had many specifications that each of the bidders needed to meet, and they are being evaluated as we speak, and I should have a report tomorrow that will determine if the low bidder actually is qualified to move forward with the project. We had three bids for each, the turf and the lighting. So we're looking forward to moving forward with those. Windstorm cleanup will be starting up. I just wanted to let everyone know that there will be some heavy equipment on campus. Our first priority is cleaning up the circle in front of Hanman Academy. And then we're moving on to the Reedsbrook Trails, and we're going to be looking to April vacation to do the trail work so that we're not having a safety or a noise issue for the surrounding schools. But we should have cleanup quite soon. Diesel tank removal has been scheduled for the last 2 weeks in June, and we'll be having heavy equipment on site at the bus garage to remove that tank, and we'll be making a fueling plan, a meeting on Friday with the vendor to make a consideration for a plan. We'll be calling other folks as well to get bids for that fueling plan. There are a lot of spring school events coming up. Tonight, for instance, there is the show choir performance over at the high school. I just wanted to encourage everybody to get out and experience what the students have to show you, because whether it's on the field or it's the art show or it's the spring concerts, just wonderful events across the board, and I always enjoy them, so I like to say keep your eye out on the calendar. And Fred Lauer and I recently went to the Bangor Region Chamber of Commerce for an intern exploration. We are looking for an intern who'd be interested in helping us with our signage campaign for the turf. And we were both entirely impressed with what the Chamber of Commerce has to offer, the programs that are well developed, and some of the partnership we could have with the Hudson, EMCC, or University of Maine. So great things happening. And then our regional application to be submitted for the regionalization effort that school districts are expected to do is happening April 15th, and we're right on track and we're full participants. So we're looking forward to getting the bounty from that effort eventually.
Okay, thank you, Karen.
Any questions of board members? Hearing none, we'll go right into committee reports and finance committee.
All right, we met on the 27th. One of the first things we went over was the warrant articles that we reviewed here tonight. Our summary that we review is a little bit more intense. One of the things that I wanted to bring up, we talked about the, there was a line in here that we talked about audiology account. And one of the reasons I want to bring it up is I thought it was a good example of going to zero accounting that we've kind of gone to, that we've gone over in the last year. Because we needed a substitute hearing teacher, we had to provide a licensed service, we had to have a licensed service provider. So this was more expensive than just a substitute teacher. And it was just a good example, I thought, of things you can't plan for. As we go forth, we just have to keep that in mind. We reviewed the revenue and projections, we as a committee approved that unanimously. We talked quite a bit of the meeting about what Regan just talked about our bond participation note. Like I said, we were very much in support of doing that. So we talked about the student numbers that are attending RSU and not attending RSU 22, and I think that's something we'll probably share with the full board sometime. It's very interesting, the number of kids that are not attending our school. We talked about homeschool kids and different opportunities there. So the VZ audit that we had decided on performing about almost a year ago was done, I assume it was done March 29th, it was supposed to be. They did do that?
Actually, it wasn't complete because the provider of the service had illness.
Okay.
So we have rescheduled that, and it's next week on Wednesday.
Okay. So that'll become a report to the Finance Committee probably next month then?
Yes.
We talked about the freedom of access request that Rick addressed already. We talked about the sale and donation of salvage materials. This came up because of the turf project. What to do with the old lights, the old poles, and the turf itself. We had some requests for that. It was our recommendation that we, because it was part of the contract for the contractor to dispose of those, that we allow them to do that and kind of stay out of that completely for liability reasons. We looked at that policy. I'm not sure if we decided we should push that policy to the policy committee or not. Did we?
We didn't decide to push it, but we did say it is aged.
Yes.
So it will be one that will come through the natural rotation to be reviewed.
Aged. So it's going to be
and then our final topic was we talked about Finance Committee joining the Budget Committee as much as possible during the budget process, and most members were on board with that. So.
Thank you. Budget Committee?
As Regan mentioned, we rolled out our first workshop, which you're approaching a little differently than years past, where we've actually set up actually weekly meetings. There will be for the next six weeks, every Tuesday.
Except for April vacation.
The budget committee will be getting together. We'll be going down through individual warrant articles. I think the report that we're getting is proof that the district is a good steward of a budget once it's been set, and I think this year the teamwork that I've already seen just behind the scenes with Regan meeting with the administrative leadership and others, and working with the building committee, we're looking at feedback on deferred capital projects that were initially rolled in as a target, for instance, on one of our warrant articles, and how to balance that out with the other requests, so that at the end of the day we end up with a budget that will pass muster at referendum. One thing we did note that this year is a little bit different, it's a lot different, quite frankly, is the way this school and the state funding formula works. Several factors have aligned themselves to reset what would really be a zero increase to a 6.4% increase at the local level if we did absolutely nothing to change the budget. And that's mainly due to the factors of each town had an increase in its real estate valuation. Our district was near the top of that increase on a statewide basis. So the good news is our property value. The bad news is it reduces the amount of state funding. That being the case, the amount that the state will finance is still may have decreased from 67 to 60. I don't know the exact, I don't have the numbers in front of me, Regan, but the equivalent to a coupon for 67% off, it's now 65. It's still a great payment. However, we had an increase in the mill rate with the state assessments, which also drove up the local assessment amount. That compounded with several other factors that happened this year, the loss of one-time or reimbursements that we've seen in years past, the E-rate, the Honeywell, the Penquist,
pre-K
program funding, VZ had a net revenue to the school, so those all together did result in an increase this year that's higher than in years past, significantly higher. But I think it's important to remember that that our zero is actually 6.4%. We did absolutely nothing to change. So we're going back in a workshop fashion, looking through each of the warrant articles, as I said, and we've got some work to do. We've got time to do it. So thanks to all that were at the meeting, and thank you in advance to all those that will roll up their sleeves and work with administration and others to bring this as close as we can to where our year zero needs to be.
Thank you, Rob. Athletic committee,
yeah, I wasn't there at that meeting, so Regan's going to help me out with that. Regan and Tom were there.
So we met on the 21st, and we opened a meeting with, there were probably, you know, half a dozen students and parents there that were interested in lacrosse and bringing lacrosse to Human Academy. So we had an informal survey was done, and there was quite a bit of interest. I'm not sure where that goes from here. We were also talking about volleyball as well, which would be for females only. And there was a lot of interest in that at the high school level. Did some athletic updates. Not sure what Bill did here tonight. Also a turf update as well. Talked about the Winterport fields right now, right in the middle school. Practices and plays, I believe, in Hamden. And we're trying to get the field down at the rec center up to snuff really so that it's safe enough to practice on. And we had a couple, had a bid, and we're trying to see if Winterport, the town of Winterport, will kind of meet us halfway on that. We can maybe, I think we talked about what, 50% of that we would do?
Up to. If we could have some degree of understanding that there would be maintenance of the effort that we would be putting forth so that we could expect that it'll be taken care of for the students to practice from here on out.
Yeah, the game should still be played at the Hamden Fields. And then we were going to try to find out what it costs to transport those kids from where to here just to see the cost differential. Am I missing anything?
John, if I may, I want to go back and highlight the very first one you said about anytime we want to start a new co-curricular and extracurricular, that's articulated the word policy regulation in the exhibit. And that line is very much sequential of what you need to do. The bottom line is it has to be approved at least a semester in advance so that we know that we can articulate the budget well in advance. So that's all. The protocol that's all constructed. And what they call an informal state, what we call an informal state and a formal state.
But where these are going is club sports that will be the case anyway, right? Right. Budget, so.
Great, thank you. Building committee, Alan.
Yeah, we met on March 23rd. A large part of the meeting was spent reviewing the consultant's report and recommended capital projects. We went down through and tried to determine what we thought was the most important to take care of and prioritize that delivery. We also discussed the fact that the electrical distribution system that comes in off Main Road and serves campus needs some required upgrades, and that could be quite expensive to take care of. Still working on that. We also discussed the turf project, the fact that the lights have to go in first because they have to get heavy equipment on the field, and you don't want it out there after the turf stands. And also the old lighting poles. It's either four or five, depending on how we go, it might be removed, are going to be donated to the Reedsbrook Trail Association for bridge construction. And the fact that we have a capital reserve account that we put deferred maintenance costs in, And there seems to be an industry or a standard of about 2% of the budget should be put into your capital reserve account. Well, if we did that, that would be about $680,000 additional dollars a year that we're not putting away for deferred maintenance. That was discussed. Then the diesel tank removal, and we had an executive session to discuss the property issue.
Thank you.
Question,
Tony?
With the other committee, we said we weren't going to donate any materials that were removed from the field. You just said we were.
Well, this is basically on campus deal. It's on our property.
On our property.
So I thought we were letting them take it all away, though.
It's on the retail trade.
No, I understand that. What I'm saying is, I thought part of the deal was they're going to haul the turf away, they're hauling the poles away, too. So if they had a plan for the poles and they were going to gain monetary value selling the poles, well, we just said we're keeping them.
True.
So that's the concept.
Let me explain that. The bids are separate. So we have the turf bid is for recycling or disposal of the turf. The lighting poles, you are right. The vendors who were bidding actually asked us for clarification. So we know that that's going to be a negotiation point.
Okay.
Likely the vendors are going to be pleased if we have another alternative for those poles. But that is going to be a point we're going to have to make with them.
Okay. Thank
you. No. Question?
Great. Education committee.
Yep, we met right before this meeting, and I apologize because I was late. We reviewed the survey results regarding moving to from quarters to trimesters at the K-5 level. There's a survey that was put out to parents with the last report cards, and we got survey results back. The majority were in favor of moving to a trimester with responses saying they want to support the teachers and do what's right for the help the teachers in the school. So that was fantastic. We discussed this as a committee. And all were in, and we actually had a vote, and we voted to support moving the pre-K to five report cards to trimesters instead of quarters, with anticipation that next year we will look at the 6 to 8 level to determine whether 6 to 8 is going to align with K to five or with high school. So we will ask for a vote.
Question. Are you going to look at AJ, or what's the...
Next year we'll look at middle school, and we had discussed at the last meeting about what people's opinions about what's best to do with it.
Yeah, I think the
probably
should go on
the AJ. We can do that next time. It's coming from a recommendation we have committee.
Yes.
So maybe it's a question for next time, but what are the benefits to the three of us?
The benefits are really it's a lot of it's a decrease in the amount of work that we're asking of our administrators and teachers.
You also get strong credits. You also get a longer period of time to get to know the kids before you refer that on. So that rather than 8 weeks, you're going to get several months. Report and parent-teacher conferences in the middle of that time frame from the beginning of school to when the trimester start finishes, so that then you will have that time right in the middle to actually meet with parents. So parents won't be blind from the beginning until that first reporting period.
Joe, did you have something?
I was going to add, the teachers felt that, or the committee felt that it wasn't really you weren't getting an accurate picture at the first quarter. And we get a much better picture of what's going on the first thing.
Was there a question up here? No.
Jen, do you have anything to add about the benefits?
I think that really captures it. I think, too, it gave students more time to master, introduce standards, because there are many assessments that we start the year with, some benchmarks. And so that, coupled with getting to know students and introducing content, it is rushed in that first quarter the way it's designed. So this gives more breathing room and a little more autonomy to really integrate.
So the way y'all frame this up in the main meeting, we'll have a presentation, I'm sure, this is, you guys will do it give you the overview as to what the benefits are, what the virtues are, and hopefully you will endorse that sentiment.
Great. We also reviewed this for our goals on the strategic plan, as we have been doing, staying on top of throughout the year, and the administrators and principals who were there really felt good about the progress that's been made, as did the committee members. I think that's it.
Thanks, Amanda. Policy? UTC, Alan?
Yeah, we had a meeting last month. A large part of the meeting was devoted to a discussion of our presentation on school security and their policies and procedures. And that was very interesting, and I think there's something that we can take out. They have a really robust plan for protecting students in that building. They never even realize that they'd be shown what they do. And it's amazing. And one thing I found interesting is many of the incidents that have happened, the perpetrator pulls a firearm. That gets the students out the hallway running out of the building so they can get out. But at the UTC, first of all, if the fire alarm does go off, they have cameras on every part of the building. And if they see that it's not really a fire, but someone doing something, at every speaker for the fire alarm, they have a blue light. And if that blue light's blinking, the faculty member or person with this knows it's not a fire. And they have a whole procedure where each faculty member or person, administrator, has a room that they are that they use to get students into the walk then when they see the blue light. I thought that was kind of interesting. But anyway, they certainly have a lot of stuff in place to care for students if there is a task. The next part of the meeting, of course, revolved around CTE. They had a fellow there, and he was on some committee that has been presenting to the state. He's also involved with the technical school in Lewiston, I believe. And of course, there really wasn't a whole lot they could do except complain at that point. So we still didn't have any answers at that point. There was also a discussion about the adult education assessment that we get every year. But they had to postpone that because the funding isn't set yet, so they couldn't set that up. And then there was also the Skills USA competition. There were 8 medal winners from Hamlin Academy. There were 6 gold medal winners and 2 silvers. Of course, the gold medal winners get to go on to Louisville, Kentucky at the national competition. So we did very well. And the UTC overall did very well.
Education Foundation, we currently still do not have a board member representative on that. We continue to ask if anyone's interested. They meet once a month, usually I think on a Tuesday evening, if my memory serves me right. So if you have any interest in being a board representative on that, let us know. Spruce Board.
We met on March 22nd, I believe, and went over all of the budgets for the Spruce and had to vote on them as a board there. I don't think we need to vote on them here.
That's correct.
Okay. So they all passed, and we are meeting again. That was all we did with that meeting. We're meeting again on April 26th at 6 p.m., and I cannot attend, so I will be looking for someone to fill that spot for me on that day, if anyone's well. April 26th.
Put a plea on the email.
Yes.
Wellness Committee.
We met a couple weeks ago. Brittany left. We talked about middle schools and doing like a kindness sort of day, right, Tom?
Wellness Day.
I don't remember what it is. I'm not on top of it tonight.
We're going to have a couple different activities going on for them. Right now, ours is being planned for the 13th right before vacation. We're all wrapping up the MEAs. We plan on having a guest speaker coming in and having a couple of different activities, but it's going to be around not just physical health, but also mental health. But also it does revolve around kindness and bullying as well. There'll be an article that will go home to the parents prior to us actually doing it, so they'll be informed of what's going on as well.
Thank you.
And we had a speaker in from the Maine Attorney General's office a couple weeks back, and it kicked off our no name calling week, and so that was the theme. And you know, we worked with Brittany and tried to line that up. So each day of the week, we had a new theme, and that was kind of organized through our civil rights team. And the guest speaker was very good, and that happened on the Monday of the week to kick off the whole week. So it was a nice week.
Thank you both for saving me on that. Thank you for saving me on that.
Community Relations Committee.
We met yesterday, and we had our first presentation from a vendor. We're looking, we're reviewing different vendors' offerings for an app for RC22. There are a lot of schools around that have an app that is mobile, designed for mobile, so tablets and phones. And it's the idea is to be sort of a one-stop area for information about the school district. And we have, we are simultaneously, because of timing, developing sort of the standards of what it is we're looking for, but also reviewing them. We would appreciate anyone coming in to these committee meetings to give us another set of eyes, more perspective. Just tonight, the education committee meeting, I realized that it would be great if, which we didn't discuss yesterday, it would be great if we had the ability to conduct a survey through them. It would be a very simple way to get some of that kind of thing out. So the more people we have coming to these meetings, and this goes to the two members of the public here as well, and we had two members of the public joining us last night, the more people we have giving us an idea of what it is they want to see in an information sharing device, basically, for the district, the better off we're going to be. We had a presentation from Aptigy last night. It is in your board packet as well, not in the adjustments. I don't know if it was printed up in the adjustments or not, but it was put into a folder that was shared with everybody as well. It's very interesting because they offer, you know, as technology moves along, 3 to 5 years is kind of the lifespan of anything. And what we can get now in an app eclipses much of what we currently have and offers us, in some cases, the same and more for the same money or less money sometimes. So we're excited about the possibilities, but we also are doing due diligence to make sure that we know that what we are looking at works in the other school districts where it's already going on. If anybody else from Community Relations has anything they want to offer about it, please feel free.
Hearing none, thank you, Scott. Any other we'll go right into policy consideration, John.
I just wanted to bring it back for second reading and adoption, given there were no changes from the no amendments from the first reading. Policy Committee brings it back, IMD, for looking for a motion for approval for second reading and adoption.
So
moved. Second.
Okay, motion for adoption of policy IMD, controversial issues, second reading and adoption has been made. And opening up for discussion. Yes, Lucas.
I have a few questions about this policy. So I recognize that discussion of controversial topics arises unexpectedly within unrelated content of classes, which is something that I've personally experienced a few times. And because teachers feel that they have a responsibility to have these conversations with the students, they do allow it to develop. So I was wondering at what point a teacher maintains the authority to redirect the conversation to the previous topic of the classroom. So for instance, back to the subject matter, such as English or science, based on the curriculum. And does that ability, the teacher's ability to redirect that discussion, allow them to avoid or stifle particular viewpoints that may arise in the discussion?
So Lucas, from your perspective, are you thinking that redirection is stifling, or are you thinking that redirection is necessary in order to?
That redirection is definitely necessary, but I also want to ensure that it's done in a proper way that allows all viewpoints to be recognized to a certain extent before the discussion is terminated. So for instance, if a discussion is taking place in the classroom and a student proposes a new idea or a new moral or topic of discussion, maybe the classroom discussion elevates or becomes more interactive. Maybe that's not what the teacher is looking for at that particular time period. They want to keep it maybe more calm. So they say, okay, let's return to the discussion about this actual classroom topic. So, like I said, science or English. And as a result, that student may have felt as if they didn't have their viewpoints recognized because they had the topic of discussion redirected because of their proposition.
I don't think there's an easy answer for that.
Yeah,
facilitation.
I think that's why I think that's a very good question, because I think that goes back to facilitation, the judgment of the classroom teacher as to how he or she will move that along, or redirect the initial topic, and allow people, allow students to participate openly, share their sentiments. I think the key would be as long as the teacher is a facilitator, not one that becomes an advocate or endorser. From my estimation, that would be the key ingredient there.
I don't know if they answer that. Building administration, do you have something to add on this? Because you're certainly the ones working on
this. My thought would be, as a high school person, I think that stuff comes up quite a bit, and we've seen that come up a bit. I think that's, Lucas's point is a good one. How do you walk that line of continuing on with what you should be doing, and but also giving airtime and space to a very important topic? I think it's a delicate balance, and it really is that the teacher needs to understand that, okay, there are things that we need to move on and get to. How much of a learning moment is this? But if they need to shut it down, I think as long as they shut it down with the understanding that, look, we need to get back to the topic, but you and I can touch base after class and then we can follow up later. I think that's the key, is that it doesn't just end. It's not like, okay, I've had enough. Because you're right, that, we don't want to get it to a point of, I disagree with what you're saying, so I'm going to stop. So I think as long as it's handled well and that student still has a chance to have a voice later on, I think that's probably key.
It's a great question, Lucas. I think my point would be on the second page of the policy, the insertion of the sentence where it says, educators shall not use the classroom as a forum to advance their personal views. Again, the facilitator to me is a person that just is neutralizing it, to move it, to facilitate it, to a process whereby you have a constructive conversation.
But I think in the policy community, we had a really good discussion talking about grade level appropriate. There may be conversations K to five that may not necessarily be appropriate for that age level, so the teacher may shut that down. Certainly at HA, it's a completely different conversation than it would be in fifth grade. And I think one of the things we did talk about too is if there are parents who have specifically said, I don't want my child to be a part of these specific conversations, teachers know like this student can't be a part of that conversation. So if another student brings up that topic, that teacher has to shut down that conversation and then maybe come back to it at a later time. I know during a policy committee meeting, Jane had talked about different incidents where something would come up, and as a teacher, she would kind of end the conversation and say, we'll come back to that later to figure out how do we have this conversation that could be controversial. So I think there are a variety of different ways that probably happens.
Yeah, I think the biggest thing is there's all these strategies and we need to make sure our teachers are equipped with how to handle all of these things. And you learn that.
And you have other policies that we discussed in the context of this one, which allows the parents to opt out of classrooms for whatever reason, so you have some other means by which you can accomplish the end result as well, as long as you know the moving parts.
Lucas, did you have another question or thought?
Excuse me.
That was a good one.
So, love Lucas's comment and all your thoughts too on that, and I think that the issue of unexpectedly arising, that was a great question. I think the response that I heard is very appropriate considering the grade level that it was described. I missed the first reading, so I'm not sure that the regulation that goes on with the policy, it's not online yet, and I know that there was a concern. I personally had a concern, there was a concern there dealing with things that did not unexpectedly arise. Those that were promoted through curriculum that may have strayed from grade level or even maybe more of a social studies environment. I love the changes that I see in the policy, however, I don't see the regulation that assures that the unexpected nature, if you will, from a parent level, given the ability of a parent to opt out of what they deem controversial issues, I still don't see language in the policy that properly advises or guides our instructors how to notify of those items that may be considered controversial by a cohort of parents as a curriculum, i.e. pre-planned conversation. So I guess I'm divided whether you make a motion to amend or motion to table unless...
That's a good point, Rob. The regulation has not been constructed yet, so what we'll do once this is affirmed, I'll go back and put the other policies that we brought to the policy committee and do a regulation. I will let you know that we had a conversation about your point at the administrative team meeting to be more of capturing your sentiment by being proactive. So when we carve something out and when we construct a special event at the DB meetings from, let's say, the Northern, we have another plan there, but we can wrap that into the regulation.
So. In some policies, we have a single page, some we have 21 pages with a lot of guidance. I guess at this time, without seeing the regulation, I move we table the adoption of second reading of INB until we're sure that language doesn't need to be inserted in the actual policy. Without the regulation in front of us, I don't feel comfortable that we address concerns we've heard at the policy meeting from citizens and from those that have expressed concern about that very issue, which is really the notification and the very well-written opt-out clause, is that there's really no way to make sure that they work without that proper curriculum notification.
Were we creating a regulation for this?
Well, I guess my point on that, once you modify the regulation, you obviously come back and modify the policy also. Also, I want to give my opinion that the feedback from the community, I basically, just so we know, we put this in perspective, I had two people convey a concern about this, so it wasn't a large number of people. So I guess my point would be, I'd recommend that we adopt the policy, construct a regulation, bring the regulation back to the policy committee, and as John and Wally know, that we may bring that regulation forward for board adoption, which is a change in the policy committee's protocol.
So to align what we have now, we have a motion and a second to approve this at second reading and adoption. Rob just made a motion to table this.
I wasn't sure an amendment. I don't think an amendment can be worked out tonight. So I guess I would move to table the motion until such time as we can either determine that the regulation, when written, is adequate or whether additional amendment needs to be put into the policy itself.
Okay. So in order for that, we will need a second, and then we would need a vote on that. So any further discussion about that? That is, we're voting on the motion to table this at this point in time.
I guess a little bit of discussion. I don't think it makes sense to table at this point in time. Regulations are based upon the policy. I think you want to make your policy first, and then you issue your regulation. If you do your regulation first, you're doing it backwards. It's from the policy that you determine the regulation. So where the regulation itself could be going to the policy committee, it will be written, and that can certainly be tweaked and discussed as a whole. I don't think it makes sense to table this and to do it all together. I think we need to do the policy first.
So all those in favor of tabling this until we have the regulation to ensure that comfortable. Three votes for tabling. All those opposed. So we're going to go back to the original motion, which had a first and a second, and open it back up for discussion.
So,
so now that we've done that, so is there something in there, Rob, that you would want to change?
Well, again, I agree with Joe. It seems a little odd that. I think the regulation has to follow the policy. I don't, in which case, I think the policy lacks the guidance that the regulation seeks to understand what the board desires to be in place for notification of curriculum. We don't actually have a policy about advising curriculum. When I search the RSU website, I see learning goals, for instance, for targets, for ELA, for sixth or seventh grade, for instance. It has none of the detailed curriculum that a parent would need to be apprised of in order to determine what was being discussed at a classroom level, or a topical level.
Rob, I think you're bringing up a point there that was discussed extensively at the policy meeting. That is it within the purview of the teachers to give advance notice to the parent of the curriculum on a daily basis? I think, and someone can correct me if I'm wrong on this, but I think our summary was that that would be very highly inappropriate to do so. So there are other policies that give parents the latitude to exempt them from the curriculum, exempt from courses, and so on and so forth. From my perspective, if we take those policies of 5 or 6 or 7 in number and have those interspersed with the regulation, it clearly allows the parents to then determine the pathway by which they can do it. But I think, again, repeating my opinion, out of 175 days for parents to receive 175 lesson plans, I think it's highly inappropriate.
So we also discussed that there is the initial meeting.
There's ample opportunity.
That's the ample opportunity to be discussing with the teacher about the curriculum.
That's right.
You know, there's the parent-teacher conference meetings, and there's also the curriculum.
Curriculum, thanks. Mm-hmm. And I think also there is, if there are topics that parents do not want their children to be involved with, they kind of know what they are, and they can have a conversation with the teacher to say, these things concern me and my family, and I would prefer, if this is going to be discussed, or if this is going to be something that's going to be part of your curriculum, if we can have a conversation ahead of time about this to see where it's headed, and then they can decide to opt out or not. So I think good communication with a teacher would be a highly positive way of doing it.
So respectfully, I would ask another member of the board to read paragraph F and H of the policy and see if that has any possibility of succeeding, given what we've just heard.
Sure. So those who haven't read the document before coming, certainly refer. Tony, did you have something?
Well, I just wanted to get back to the title of the policy, and that is controversial. So we're not dealing with every day. We don't expect the teacher to send the curriculum every day. But if they're going to start talking to third grader about a hot topic like snorting condoms or eating Tide Pods, well, that's something that they need to call me and say, hey, can we talk to your kid, tell them not to put a condom in their nose, or eat laundry detergent? So we're not saying, hey, we want to know are they going to learn ABCs today. We want the controversial, and I think that's getting lost in your statement. It's not going to be 175 curriculums sent home. It's going to be, hey, we're going to talk about Tide Pods today. Well, do I want my kid learning about Tide Pods that people eat them? Mm. Not in second grade. So that's the conversation. That's the policy that needs to be written, that we're going to notify parents when something like that's discussed, not, oh, are we going to talk about George Washington today?
I guess
That's why we have to define controversial. We can't
George Washington was a slave owner. That's controversial. That can become very controversial. Talking about George Washington's relationship with his slave, because his name was Hermes.
So now we're going to censor U.S. history?
No. That's not censoring U.S. history. My point is that it's all controversial. And so yes, it can turn into 100%.
And so step out of this as a school board, and I'm speaking from my perspective here, I don't want to put our teachers and our school district in the position where we are liable for not sending a communication home for something that we perceive not to be controversial, but is controversial at home.
Yeah, I was gonna say, you know, I know what I expect my kids to hear in school and college. If I have an issue with something, you know, like a current political topic, and I don't want my kids to be in the room that's being discussed, I would send an email to the teacher. And the teacher could have that discussion with me. And that, then the policy would kick in for that teacher that, okay, I've been notified by this parent that he doesn't want his son involved in this discussion. But I don't expect the teachers that have, you know, they see how many kids in a day to have an understanding of what could be controversial for 60-some sets of parents or guardians. We take that upon ourselves as parents as part of, you know, being involved in our kids' education. But have that communication with the teacher, let them know what you think is controversial, and if it's a current topic, let them know.
And how do you handle going back on Lucas's question? I'm looking at Michelle Messler sitting in the classroom. Let's say she's 42 minutes into the lesson, all of a sudden the student gets in, asks a question, then becomes controversial.
That's not what we're talking about.
That's impromptu, but it could react, the parent could react.
But that's not what we're talking about. We're talking about predetermined planned curriculum. And with all due respect, I would like someone to read aloud, not myself, paragraph F or H, and explain to me how a parent can respond in accordance with the policy.
I don't think it's necessary that someone read that aloud. We have this in front of us, though.
Oh, okay.
Honestly,
from my point of view, my issue with the controversial issue is basically explained in A, B, and C. As long as that, and it may be different for older kids versus smaller kids, but to me, as long as that teacher takes a neutral point, and allows those kids to express their viewpoint and monitors the situation, that's what I would expect the teacher to do. I don't want the teacher to insert themselves one side or the other. And that's, I guess, what I thought this policy was more about than whether we were going to teach curriculum or not teach curriculum.
Right. So respecting the board's request, chair's request not to read the whole thing, I'll just read one sentence, paragraph F. Parents have options to restrict their child's participation in part or in whole in any plan, discussion, or course of a controversial nature. How is a parent, unless I find out after the fact when my child comes home and is upset about an item that they've been taught in a class that you would not expect to be taught in, how would I know in advance to allow them or to restrict them from being part of that conversation of a plan, meaning I previously written curriculum, if I was not made aware of it? How do I become aware of it?
Why wouldn't that guide a regulation? So I don't even understand why you're talking about that. That would guide a regulation. So we already talked that this policy guides a regulation. You said it wasn't in the policy to even guide that, and you just pointed out where it was.
No, you're missing the point. How are we guiding? This is not just a guidance for the parent. This is a guidance for our
administration.
We're looking at overhauling a policy based on one specific incident of the administration.
I think it's more than one incident. It's much more than one incident.
We've had two parents make a complaint about one incident, and this is the first time that this policy's come up in the 2.5 years that I've been on the board. So is this the policy was last updated, in 2003? So it's not, to me, it doesn't appear that it's a policy that has had many issues over the years. It's something that there was one specific incident on that came up that we're looking at. We're amending the policy throughout the policy committee meeting that we had. We had a long conversation about this one single incident that we're changing the policy on wasn't even regular instruction. It was on a half day of school. Focus was on kindness, and one discussion came up. Through the policy committee meeting and talking with administration, one of the things that we talked about is maybe on half days and when there's wellness day, kindness day, whatever it is, sending a notice home, hey, this is what we're gonna do, it's not gonna be a normal day. So I think through the policy committee meeting, we talked about how administration really learned a lesson from this, that when we're changing the curriculum and changing what we're discussing in a day, we should probably really take a closer look at having or sending out a notice to parents so they know what's going to be the topic that day. Is that correct?
That's
the conversation we had?
That's right.
Well, perhaps we need to provide better guidance into the parents. And as someone mentioned earlier, and as Scott suggested, perhaps we need to provide a forum or a format by which parents can advise in advance teachers, for which now our teachers would be liable for keeping track of 65 different parent requests.
Format's already there, Rob.
You have the right to schedule a meeting
with a teacher tomorrow.
That's right.
You have that right.
Talking about something after the fact, a child cannot unhear something else.
You as a parent can set a meeting with your teacher, sit down with the teacher, and have a conversation while you're having it right now. Put them on notice. If this topic comes up, I'd like to have my child exempted from that. You can do that anytime.
And parents do that. And that was part of the discussion where if in a classroom one student brings something up, the teacher already knows this other student in the classroom is not supposed to be part of those conversations, so the teacher shuts that down.
I suspect the reason this hasn't been more prevalent is because we haven't had these issues arise until recently. And consider that as a possibility. So dealing with something that has changed, I think, is apropos in policy.
Okay. So we have debated this. We've heard multiple perspectives.
Do we have a new thing? Anyone else want to make a comment? We have a motion, we have a second, we will be voting on this. The motion again is approval of second reading and adoption of this policy, and then Rick and the administration team will move forward with developing a regulation within this. So all those in favor of the policy? All those opposed? Three opposed. Alan, did you?
I didn't.
Are you abstaining or are you voting?
I vote in favor. I'm willing to give administration the opportunity to come up with a regulation to address the issue.
Okay, thank you. Let's have a good discussion.
Thank you.
Old business regarding the calendar.
Yes, following up our last meeting, we discussed the pros and cons associated with the school commencing prior to Labor Day versus after Labor Day. These two are before you to show the difference between the two, and as I pointed out in my agenda notes, probably the biggest difference, obviously starting after Labor Day, but also the high school graduation would be moved to June 16th by starting after Labor Day, because we'd only have 2 days. June 7th will be 172 days. By law, you need to have 170, and that's the reason for pushing June graduating from the 16th. We discussed this with Administrative Council. For your benefit, it was a pleasure of the administrative team to recommend the board to adopt the call to adopt the calendar that starts school prior to Labor Day.
So with the one that starts after,
mm-hmm.
Where's the 170-day mark?
The 170-day mark is June 5th. So that means if you miss 2 days, you're fine. If you miss three, you're not in compliance with law.
What's the 110-day mark for the first one, prior, pre-Labor Day?
The pre-Labor Day, that would be, let me see.
2 days.
2 days, that's right, thank you, Thomas. 2 days, so thank you. All right, Tony, thank you very much.
Tony,
so I want that. So there you go. As you
know. So basically, there would be, under the first calendar, how many days have we missed with snow? Before we run into a problem with graduation?
With the first calendar?
How many extra days of unbudgeted snow days is that what you're talking
about? Well, no, what I mean is that one of the reasons why, I mean, in the second calendar, the later calendar, you've moved graduation a week later, because obviously it's a tight fit there. So my question is, if we had excess snow days, how many snow days can we have under the first calendar, the early one?
Three.
We can only have three, and then we run into a problem with graduation. So, for example, for this year, we've had four snow days.
We've had five.
So is that going to create a problem this year for graduation?
Maybe I misspoke. Let me just hesitate. Tony, help me on this. So,
motion to adjourn, is that how?
167 is May 31st. So 167, so 170th day is on June 5. Okay?
For which calendar?
Wait, you need to switch to the other. Starting after Labor Day. He's interested in
before
Labor Day.
Okay, I'm sorry, Joe. Okay. So, 10 days, that means 169, 70, we have 4 days. We have a buffer of 4 days.
How many snow days do we have this year?
Five.
So, just for the discussion purposes, I think that actually having graduation a week later makes some sense in terms of, we've been having a lot of snow days over the past few years. And we actually were kind of lucky this year in that, Rick did a lot of late starts and early starts. In the past, those would have been full days, and so that's just, I think, some food for thought on, perhaps this later Labor Day calendar actually makes some sense in regards to graduation.
So how many days with calendar B?
What?
Go ahead.
Yeah.
Buffer do we have before we would have to push graduation back a week?
We could miss 4 days.
In addition to the three buildings, 4 days?
Yes, because if you look at the calendar, now process with me. Okay.
So 7 days.
You have 169 days. You have 169 days on June 3rd. So if you go that week, you have 174 days. So you can miss 4 days. If we miss the fifth day, like we did this year, then we're in trouble. However, you could take and change one of your in-service days and flip that. Joey, my opinion on the graduation doesn't really matter to me. If it's any interest, Bangor's on June 16th. So it doesn't make any difference. We do have to be cognizant of that floating scenario that you're bringing up. But we would have 4-day buffer if we stayed with graduation on June 9th.
4 days including the 3 days that are in, or 4 days total? It's more days with the second calendar, right? The buffer is bigger with the second calendar?
Yes,
It's 7 days with, with the second calendar.
I'm not sure I understand your question. Let me say it this way. We have 179 days built in,
okay?
Which includes 3 storm days.
All right.
So at the end of May, we have 169 days that we've gone. If we don't miss any school, we're good, we're 169. If you go the first week of June, now you've gone 174, which means now you can move four, you can lose 4 days along the way, and now you're back to 170, so we're okay. If we replicate it this year, then we have the problem.
Okay, so okay. 4 days for the first calendar.
Yes.
7 days buffer for the second calendar.
Yes.
All right. That's including all the snow days.
The second calendar would be less likely to ever have to move graduation.
Yes,
sure. How many times are you going to get graduation?
No. So to get back to my original point was looking for parent input, not necessarily this year, but we have all of these tools. We have public relations.
Mm-hmm.
You know, for example, I took an informal, unscientific poll of every kid that walked through my office last month. 876 families came through my office, and I asked them. Granted, not all of them are RSU 22, maybe fifth, and it was overwhelming in support of going after Labor Day. So, what I'm asking is if we can include in our consideration, not giving them a totalitarian vote, but weighing that on the creation of the calendar, because that's why, as board members, we're here is to give the public input. We listen to admin, we listen to what people voted for us say, and we put it together and we come to a decision. And so opening it up to input from the public is doing due diligence.
I have a suggestion.
We got one of our customers right here. I'd be interested to hear what Lucas, not to put you on the spot, Lucas, but what you would think about starting before Labor Day versus after Labor Day, potentially the idea of moving graduation back an entire week. I'd just like to hear your thoughts.
Working as it is for the past few years, I think, fine, but that's with the assumption that we're going to have some days that we can say, oh, maybe today we can go for half of the day, or we can get away with a delay. And I recognize that sometimes we're not always going to be able to safely get away with that, so I think there is definitely a benefit to having more available days to miss, whether or not that means we have more built-in actual school days. I think more of the students, the majority of the students would recognize that it's more beneficial to have more available days, even if that means more days of school, assuming that we have the ability to miss more days and increase the safety for the students.
So well.
And we would always have the available, they would always be available to take some service days away. So that could, and how many do we have?
Well, this calendar here, you have one in October, you have one in January, and you have one in March. So we have 3 days that we could offer.
Right. October probably wouldn't come into play.
No, hopefully not.
Right. So let's say January, so you have two other days to play.
That's correct. Or if you read the newspaper over in SAD 44, they missed 11 days this year. They've added an hour to the day for 8 weeks. I'm not advocating that, but
that's awesome.
Lincoln did. So you could do that as well. There's options there. Or you can apply for a exemption.
Has the state ever granted any exemptions?
They have, yes.
They have, because it seems I'm always reading in the paper, denied.
There's been a few. But I can tell you, in my tenure here, 5 has been fairly common. 4 is probably the common number. I'm just making it up. 5 is over the top a little bit, but it's common. And I wouldn't want to make a calendar, being your superintendent right now, to judge on how we're going to graduate. And I don't get up in the morning and say, well, is this going to affect graduation? I don't even think of that.
Can't, liability-wise, the kids can't.
No, of course not. No, of course not.
So it would be inconvenience of...
Yeah.
We talked about this. Jane brought up some really good points about the education and the benefits to having this kind of tapered staggered start.
Yes.
And I wonder, the administrative team is interested, they prefer the before Labor Day. Could you guys just share some of the points that, the reasons why you prefer that calendar?
Yeah. Bill, yes, that's right. The team here, we talked about that. So can you give some feedback to the board on the advocacy to start before Labor Day was based on?
Well, one was the high school piece, but also the transition back for students, building that capacity, you know, 2 days, then four, then a full day week. That's really beneficial in building that capacity. And so teachers overwhelmingly, certainly in my building, had preferred that.
It would really allow us in the first 2 days in the end of August to do those things, the getting back to school things, the paperwork things, the setting the expectations things before UTC starts. When UTC starts on that Tuesday, I'm not holding my kids back from UTC, which means there'd be more things for us to catch up with them on, whereas if we had those 2 days before, it would give us that buffer and that ability.
Mary, anything to add on that from your perspective?
No, I agree with these folks. We also, it's a nice opportunity to ease teachers in because we often will do a fair amount of professional development and getting back to school and so forth, and that allows them a little bit of time right before the kids come in to be able to get everything prepared, so it's kind of a nice way to ease everybody into the new school year.
And I know we talked about not allowing one piece to drive the schedule, but you know, at the high school level, we have a number of students that participate in things that start before school, whether they be extracurriculars, sports, activities, or whatever, and they've got to come back 2 weeks beforehand anyway and be a part of that. So I know that that's a portion of our population, but it's a portion of the population I don't want to ignore, and they're going to be back anyway as part of it.
But there are 2,000 other members of students, families, and teachers that are then being driven back to school for the benefit of a couple hundred.
Yeah, so I'm not saying I'm ignoring that. I'm just saying it's
five. Well, that's why I want the input. That's why I want the input from those families, the other 2,000 families that don't have high school athletes, the other, you know, several hundred teachers that maybe they don't have to go back to school that week before Labor Day. That's what I'm getting at.
To be a stickler. I'm going to make a motion for discussion first. We ought to have a motion
for
discussion. So I would move that we approve the draft August 30th start date calendar that we approved for first reading, and we approve that same calendar for second.
I'm sorry, the motion was for the which calendar?
For The title of the calendar is Draft for Board of Directors, August 30th start, ours from the 20th.
Right.
So that's the 2 days prior to Labor Day.
Got it. Is there a second? Obviously, if this motion fails, then it looks like the calendar is good. Michelle, do you mind if a couple of members have asked to kind of ask you what you're thinking?
Sure. I agree with what Bill was saying. I mean, from a high school perspective, we actually only would have 1 day with all the kids there. We'd have 1 day because the very first day is partial attendance. It's K to 9. It's great to get our freshmen in the building. They would be in the building for 2 days. Then we would have 1 day where we would have the full boat. And that's a day where, quite frankly, we're all getting back to school. We're not doing a whole lot of deep content knowledge. It's a lot of paperwork. It's a lot of let's run through the schedule here. You know, I'm Mrs. Metzler. Here's your, you know, this is where history class is, and handing out books or figuring out all of that sort of paper, all that stuff you get at the beginning of the year, all those papers that we get as parents too, right? So I think that's a good breaking point to have that be a Friday this year. And then starting Tuesday with, then I could start as a teacher, I could start Tuesday morning with, all right, it's school time. Like, we don't need to worry about all the other forms and who's got this and who's got that. So I think looking at it this year, I like the start of before Labor Day and those 2 days. I think it's a good conversation to have each year because of Labor Day's moving target.
So do you feel, I mean, obviously there's going to be disagreement among teachers as well, but do you feel like that's probably a majority from those you've spoken with would, or have you been spoken
There's with? Always that, there's the emotional feeling of, yes, I want to start after Labor Day, right? But then when you look at the sort of logistics and what needs to happen, it makes a lot of sense to start before. So there's this sort of heart-brain separation, but I think that most people see the logic and say, like, it makes sense to start before Labor Day. I do have a question, though, about the difference in the two calendars. It appears as though there are three extra days in the one that starts after Labor Day, added on June, but only 2 days at the beginning. I didn't know where that third day came from.
Say that again, Michelle.
So in the one that starts before Labor Day,
yeah.
The end day is the 12th of June.
13th of June.
Sorry. And it's a half day. Yes? Yes. And so then if you look at the one that starts... Sorry, the one that starts before Labor Day ends with an early dismissal day on a Friday.
Yeah.
Yes.
And the one that starts after Labor Day, there are three additional days, student days in June.
Yeah.
That have been added, not two. So I was just wondering where that third, I couldn't figure out in my three.
There's only two.
Oh, there's only two?
Yeah, there's only two, yeah.
Okay, but it went to a full day and not
it
a
did.
Half day.
Yeah. It's 2.5 days versus two.
Right.
Versus.
Okay, I didn't know why.
Oh, Rick, I have one more question on the, because she mentioned that it's K through nine, that first day of school. So
yes.
The seniors are not going until the second day of school.
Yes.
Right.
So when you were counting the 170 days, were you counting for the K through nine or for the seniors?
Yes, I am.
That was an either or, it wasn't a yes. Were you doing it for the K through nine or for the seniors? When you were saying 170 days, was that for the K through nine or was that for 10 through 12?
If I remember correctly, I'll try to look it up. When it's for a day off, it doesn't count towards the 170 days. You have to have at least, what, 50% attendance?
Yeah.
So the K to 9 would get you beyond that 50%.
Yes.
Okay, so it's not for grade, it's for the school as a whole.
It's for the.
Yeah.
Okay.
I believe that's
yes, that's right. Thank you, Jill.
Thank you, Michelle. Okay. Any discussion? We have a motion and a second. For the calendar that starts before Labor Day.
Excuse me.
Okay. All of those in favor, show of hands, please. Raise those hands back.
It's
not
unanimous. I'm
zooming.
Do we get a count? I was hoping to
get a count, but you had a desire. Hold them up so I can type your name.
Okay, so we have Ethan Jane Walling here. Jessica Scott.
Jessica King,
Scott, Rob, Emily, John, and Mindy. Emily, John, and Mindy. Okay. And then those opposed.
Those opposed.
Tony, Joe. Tony, Joe, Jim, and Jessica. Tony, Joe, Jim, and Jessica.
So the motion passes. Calendar has been adopted for before Labor Day. And I do think the communications committee, I don't know if we can try to take Tony's feedback about the survey of some sort just to kind of get some information, of maybe even from our teaching faculty. Something to consider.
Motion to adjourn.
We have executive session. We have actually more business.
Yeah, we have
to make a motion to extend the meeting.
We do. Can I have a motion to extend the meeting, please?
So moved. Second.
All those in favor? All those opposed? How many opposed?
We're going to go to the library for our technical.
I had a motion to adjourn.